Good morning, everyone. Today we are going to do the sonnet, The Lotus by Toru Dutt. Born in a Hindu family in Kolkata on March 4, 1956, Toru Dutt was brought up by her doting father, Gobind Chandra Dutt, who was a linguist and cultured man. Besides contributing to the Dutt family album, 1870, which also contained contributions by Raj Narain. Har Chandar, Umesh Chandar, and Soshi Chandar, Gobind Chandar, published The Loyal Hours in 1876 and Cherry Stones in 1881. Toru's mother, Kshetramoni, was well versed in English and Bengali. She was a woman of sweet disposition and was steeped in the Hindu myths and legends. In those days, the Dutt family had distinguished itself in the whole of Bengal for its creative activities. Born in such a cultured family, it was but natural for Toru to indulge in literary exercises from a very early age. In 1862, some members of the Dutt family, including Gobind Chandar, was attracted by the glamour of the West and Gospel of Christ. The conversion to Christianity caused a temporary estrangement between Toru's parents, but later Mrs. Gobind reconciled herself to the changed situation and became an ardent Christian. At this time, Toru was 6 and Aru was 8, and their only brother Abju was 11. The children had a private tutor at home, and the father also took care of their education. The first calamity that befell the family was the death of Abju at the age of 14 in 1865. For their consolation, the sisters began to read Paradise Lost repeatedly and buried themselves in literary pursuits. In 1869, the family left for Europe and two girls attended a French school at Nice. A year later, the family went to London, where Toru took lessons in music. Living in a furnished house here, Toru and Aru started doing translations into English. While in Europe, Toru, along with her sister, acquired astonishing knowledge of French and English. In 1871, the family moved to Cambridge, where both the sisters attended the higher lectures for women and made friends with Miss Martin, who was to be Toru's lifelong friend and the recipient of most of her letters. In 1873, the family returned to Kolkata after a lapse of 4 years. Now the sisters plunged, in the words of Edmund Gosse, into a feverish dream of intellectual effort and imaginative production. In 1875, Toru, along with her father, started studying Sanskrit. She arranged for the publication of a sheaf gleaned in French fields, which appeared in 1876. Her study of Sanskrit was prompted by the hope, as she said, that thereby she would be able to bring out another sheaf, not gleaned in French, but in Sanskrit fields. Toru was frail and fragile in her physical appearance. When she was a little girl, her father took down the following lines about her: puny and elf-like, with disheveled tresses, self-willed and shy, never heeding that I call, intent to pay her tenderness addresses, to bird or cat, but most intelligent. The shadow of death began to darken her life quite early, and when the grim scepter arrived, she was ready to welcome it. By 1877, Toru's health had run down and she was ill, very ill, and had recurrent attacks of fever, cough, spasm, and blood spitting. She was obliged to keep within doors and was so weak that she could not even write her letters. It's a harrowing tale indeed, but steeped in heroism. On August 30, 1877, Toru died. Toru Dutt is an outstanding name in the history of Indo-Anglian poetry. She is one of the most poignant examples of those who, before their proper time, passed through the door of darkness. Her life is a mixed story of sunshine and sorrow, beauty and tragedy, success and regret. If her works fill us with awe and wonder, her early death leaves us saddened, repenting. Coming to the poem, the sonnet, Lotus, let me read the sonnet out for you before we explain it. Love came to Flora asking for a flower that would of flowers be undisputed queen. The lily and the rose long, long had been rivals for that high honor. Bards of power had sung their claims. The rose can never tower like the pale lily with her Juno mien. But is the lily lovelier? Thus between flower factions ran the strife in Psyche's bower. Give me a flower delicious as the rose and stately as the lily in her pride. But what of color? Rose red love first chose, then prayed, no, lily white, or both provide. And Flora gave the lotus. Rose red died, and lily white, queenliest flower that blows. The poem Lotus is based on a fanciful thought. The god of love goes to Flora, the goddess of flowers, and asks her to give him the most beautiful flower, which can be the queen of flowers. The rose and the lily have for long been claiming that honored place. Flora gives him the lotus and thus gives it the highest place among the flowers. The lotus has both the whiteness of the lily and the redness of the rose. It is a sonnet, a poem of 14 lines. Its rhyme scheme is ABBA, ABBA, CDCDDC. Professor C.D. Narasimhaiya has all praise for the sonnet. He calls it a miracle of creativity. He writes, "The lotus shows more than potential, the demonstrable working of a genius. The poem is in the nature of a gift from one culture to another, a mature response to a challenge conceived as personal and racial. In the line, bards of power have sung their claims. Compare the lotus with William Cowper's The Lily and the Rose, written when the poet was 50 and obviously provided the stimulus to Thoreau to see how much can be done with so little by one who was not to the language born." In the first few lines, that is, in the lines 1 to 8, the goddess of love came to Flora, the goddess of flowers and plants, and asked for a flower that was undisputably the most beautiful, queen-like. He said that the lily and the rose have for long been rivals, claiming this high position, the queen of flowers. Great poets have sung the claims of both the flowers. Cowper sang the beauty of the lily and the rose. He speaks of a discussion in Psyche's bower between groups among the flowers opposed to each other, factions, opposite groups. Some claim the high position for the rose. Some say the rose can never be as beautiful and stately as the golden lily, which has appearance like Juno, Juno's beautiful and proud face. Juno is Jupiter's wife in Greek mythology. She is very proud and beautiful, but some question if the lily is more beautiful than the rose. In this way, there is a dispute among the groups of flowers in Psyche's bower. Psyche is the goddess who loved Cupid, the god of love, in Greek mythology. The god of love wants to have a flower which is undisputably the most beautiful of all, flower fit to be the undisputed queen of flowers. Next lines, that is 9 to 14. The god of love came to goddess of flower again, flowers, and wanted to have the most beautiful flower fit to be the undisputed queen of flowers. It should have the delicious fragrance of the rose and the stately grandeur of the lily. The god of love first thought of the red rose. Then he said that it should be like the white lily. He wanted the goddess of flowers to give him a flower which should have the qualities of both, the red rose and the white lily. The goddess of flowers gave him the lotus, which has the qualities of both the flowers, the red color of the rose and the grandeur of the white lily. The lotus is the most beautiful and grandest of all the flowers that blow on earth. This much for today. Thank you.